What up, YouTube? It's Retro Pals with Danny and Alex. Wait a minute, this isn't YouTube. What up, Hitbox? This is Retro Pals with Danny and Alex.
Good enough.
Yeah, nailed it. So yeah, this is our show. Welcome to it.
Welcome.
Cool.
To game.
In case you're unfamiliar, we were previously known as the Adventure Pals. We are Danny and Alex. We live here in Austin, Texas, and we have a bunch of weird games that we like showing people. Games that we put up for vote every week on our Patreon. And this week, people wanted to see something called Clive Barker's Busytown.
Bless you! Bless you and your endless curiosity.
It was, yeah, I didn't want to spoil what it was. Someone actually asked what it was, and I was like, nope, gonna have to vote for it if you want to see it. And that's what a majority of people did. They were deadly curious, and I can't blame them. This is something that I discovered a while back. It's something that I've shown off in real-world spaces before. I don't think it's been shown on the internet before, though. This is a Retro Pals exclusive. But before we get to that, though, that requires a little bit of setup here. So let's start up our first game.
Mm-hmm.
And in case you're wondering what system is being featured this week, it's this one.
I saw the eek!
That one beeps a little bit longer than the other VMUs we have. Yep, Dreamcast, the console of dead batteries. So we're starting off tonight with a look at Sega Smash Pack Volume 1, a very curious late release for the system. It's basically an emulation package that has a whole bunch of Sega Genesis games in it. There's a slight problem with that, though. Let's see how the emulation is.
There's been
good emulators over the years. There's been some bad ones. The recent At Games console, the plug and play, apparently has really bad sound emulation.
Ooh.
That's an issue that's affected Genesis emulators in particular over the years.
I've actually noticed that.
But a Sega authored emulator should sound better, right?
hold on.
Well, they tried. Sorta.
Oh, not a fan.
Sonic not looking too good. Just to give you an idea of what this emulation package is like, let me play something familiar. The first level of Sonic the Hedgehog. You guys know what that sounds like, right?
Yeah.
It sounds just like this.
I don't know how to tell you this, but it actually doesn't.
Really?
No, I mean...
Alex, I played through Sonic dozens of times.
Did you play
Do you remember his
it?
Dinosaur pal Yoshi, the flying cape? Hello?
Did you play it on the Game Boy Advance, perhaps?
Oh, yeah, that was the best Sonic.
Yes. Oh, honey, I have something.
This actually
to
is
tell.
Pretty reminiscent
it
of
actually...
Sonic Genesis for the GBA. Oh, that sound when he goes through the tunnels. Oh, it's so, so good. Yeah, this is just unfortunate. Every sound, every part of Sonic the Hedgehog that you know and love, that you're familiar with from your childhood, it's wrong. It's wrong in some way. They impressively managed to get almost everything wrong in some way. Actually, let me adjust the volume so I can hear it too. Oh, it's marvelous.
I adjusted it on our end as well.
So yeah, the thing you may notice is that the video emulation, not bad. The controls are okay too, there's no, or at least very little input lag. But the sound.
Oh, the sound.
It's kind of a deal breaker. You can't look past that sound. Interesting thing about this collection, though, is that it came out right before the Sega Dreamcast was famously discontinued by Sega. They got out of the hardware market. They decided they wanted nothing to do with it anymore. And there's an interesting thing that happened because of that. Do you have a thing to bring up, Alex?
I pressed it. There you go.
There you go. So, here's the story. This game was released, and at the time there were very busy ISO rippers back in the day, ripping Dreamcast games the instant they came out. If you want to know just how prominent Dreamcast piracy was back in the day, you could literally get ISOs from a website called fucksega.com. Not a joke.
Oh,
you could just
God.
Go there, direct download, play them on your Dreamcast. That's how much of a problem piracy was. However, a guy named Gary was apparently a little bit miffed about his last project at Sega. He'd been working there for about a decade, and I guess he got word down the pipe that the Dreamcast just wasn't happening, it wasn't succeeding. They were scaling back, soon he would lose his job, and this was his very last project. So what Gary decided to do is he put a file on the root directory of the Sega Smash Pack disc called echelon.txt.
I love that it's called echelon.txt.
Echelon was the popular Dreamcast ISO releasing group. And on it was this message here, where he basically says, hey, if you do this and this and this, you have a fully functional Genesis emulator. Just make sure to thank Uncle Sonic. And that's what they did. They were all like, hey, exclusive from Echelon, it's a working Dreamcast emulator. Thanks, Uncle Sonic. So, yeah.
So this emulator...
Not so great to use nowadays. Back when the Dreamcast was new, though, it was a boon. You could play Sega Genesis games on your TV. It was great. Just make sure you keep the volume down. One quirk we noticed messing around with this emulator, me and Alex way back when, is that it handles voices especially poorly. You know what? Let's see. This got us to thinking. We heard distorted voices in some of the games, and we were thinking, what Genesis games have the most digitized voices in them? How badly can we put this emulator to the test? The game we picked to fully test the limits of this thing was Richard Scarry's Busytown. Let's put that on.
Oh, it's a thing. Also, the audio stuttering is from the Dreamcast. I was hearing it through the thing, and I was just like, oh.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, my Dreamcast doesn't like the beep. It doesn't like the menu in that game. It should be better now, though. So we're going old school here. 90s kids, like and subscribe if you remember this.
You just want people to like and also subscribe.
Yes, it's true. Ah, good old Utopia boot disc. The first way you could pirate Dreamcast games back in the day.
What's up with that reindeer?
It's
that
a reindeer.
That reindeer has bothered me my entire life. Who is that reindeer?
I don't know.
Who is this asshole? Sorry, this was... My first experience with emulation was literally this. It was literally the Utopia disc loader.
Inexplicable reindeer on the Utopia CD loader.
And I've developed an anger towards that reindeer since. I'm sorry, reindeer.
Just wants to give you free games.
Oh, now he's so cool!
Oh, look at those reflections. Oh, that's next gen. I'm gonna ask Alex to pump up the Elgato volume
just a little bit. Pump up the volume?
Because more than anything, I want to be sure that you hear the voices in this game. May God have mercy on our souls. We're actually doing this.
Yeah, this does need an S. Bloody hand, apple.
That would be appropriate. You had to make do with what you had back in the day. Like, emulators weren't perfect, and anything for a console was just, wow. Get all the ROMs, play them all. Including Richard Scarry's Busytown. So already from the beginning, if you're familiar with the original game, you'll know the music is a different key. It's been tuned down a little bit. Almost sounds like it's being rendered in a minor key or something. That actually helps. Oh, all these people are having their work ruined on this terrible emulator.
Welcome to Busytown. Climb on board the Applecopter and fasten your seatbelt. Move the mouse to pick the playground you want to visit, and click. In the playground, you'll become a Busytown character by simply moving the mouse.
So yeah, you have some hint of why we like this so very much. At times we have called this Clive Barker's Busytown, American McGee's Busytown, and Richard Busy's Scarytown.
I remember Richard Scarry.
Yes.
Richard Busy's Scarytown. People are calling it Vaporwave Town. It's too scary to be Vaporwave Town.
It's really spooky.
I'm smoking the firefighter.
Well,
yeah, I know you're all getting it, but yes, it is like everyone is really high as well.
Yeah, they're either high or evil or some combination of the two. So what I'll do here is play through a little bit of Richard Scarry's Busytown.
Oh, please
get
to
it. The net will save people's lives.
Yeah. Oh, it gets better. It gets so much better.
This siren makes a really loud sound.
The unique thing about this game is that, yeah, it has a ton of voice from a bunch of different voice actors, some of which have very low voices, and generally the lower the voice is, the more distorted it becomes.
Please say
in this
we're
version.
Gonna meet Captain Salty.
We will meet Captain Salty.
Yes!
The red flashing light gets everyone's attention.
God, just this distorted, warpy music in the background, and now with the bleeping.
And I would lose my shit. I'm so sorry.
Well, we put together our fire engine. Let's take a nap.
I could use a rest.
A rest. Yeah, Alex enjoys this. Oh man, there's a fire. Oh, good. Now I can go back to bed. Oh no, we gotta.
I need my raincoat to keep me dry. And here is my helmet.
No helmet.
Down the pole!
And now, holy shit, everyone get out of the way. It's time to put out a fire. Get out of the way! Get fucked, Busytown. There's a fire! Do you even know? Just get out the way! God! Do this business now.
Jump! Jump! We'll catch you! Jump! Jump! We'll catch you! Jump! Jump!
I like this family though.
We'll catch you!
A bunch of nice cats. Show off. I'll show him. Okay, we gotta hook it up to the fire.
Gotta put out that fire.
Let's put out the fire. There we go.
I'm just putting fire.
Don't worry, no need to thank me. Just doing my job. What? Fire? What? No, that doesn't do anything. Alright. There.
Good job! The fire is out.
Okay. Yeah, take a bath, idiot. We're giving everyone baths today. Oh, now we're working at the deli. I love this part. This is my personal favorite.
I quote this so much. So
would you take care of the deli while I'm gone? Sure, Bruno! Thank you so much.
I'm gonna head out to the back and get stoned as fuck.
Hi.
Thank you.
I would like to have some green peas.
Going to the store just to order some green peas? You got it. Hamburger it is.
Oops. That's not my order.
Oh, sorry, dude. Guess I'm gonna have to eat it myself now. This is a good scam. Alright, where were the peas? I think if you serve enough people, you can beat this level, so let's try and do that. Usually when I play this, though, I just serve everyone the wrong thing and spill all their drinks and stuff. This game's weirdly fun when it's played like this.
Looks great, Huckle.
Thank you! You're welcome!
Hi. I would like to have some carrots.
Oh. A rabbit ordering carrots. Didn't see that coming. Would it be a walking stereotype?
Have you no shame, rabbit? Have you no shame?
Why don't you order bread or ice cream or cookies?
Chocolate milk or anything.
There we go.
Have some cake, idiot.
Oops, that's not my order.
Excuse me, Marie Antoinette said let them eat cake. You are a them, so you will eat cake!
Eat our gosh darn cake. Holy these carrots, good god. There they are.
Looks great, Huffle. Thank you. You're welcome.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Hi. I would like to have some hot chocolate.
Here's some hot chocolate,
huh?
You got it, friend.
Uh-oh, too much. Uh-oh, too much. It's overflowing.
There you go.
Looks great, Huckle. Thank you. You're welcome.
I love that exchange at the end every time.
Hi. I would like
classic
to have
combo.
Some carrots and a bowl of soup.
People in here order some fucked up stuff. They'll be like, hi, I want some broccoli and a chocolate milk.
They want chocolate milk with everything differently.
Yeah.
It's so weird.
Carrots and soup. Carrots and soup. Well, let me just scroll through our menu. I love this farty little reggae tune in the background, just kind of very slowly plodding along.
And because, yeah, it turns the tune from whatever it is to, like, you're right, this, like, reggae-type mix.
Yeah.
Looks great, Huffle. Thank you. You're welcome.
Downbeat in minor key, reversed, chopped, screwed.
Hi. I would like to have some cookies and some hot chocolate.
I'm feeling this guy.
This guy knows.
That's me every day.
It is, though.
I forgot how much I enjoy this game. I don't know why. It's a very simple kids game. This was one of the very few games to get the early childhood rating.
It
was for very young children. But kids of all ages can enjoy it on the Sega Dreamcast. Did I miss the cookies? There's the cookies.
I love that.
Alright, I'm gonna go out to the store and just order a plate full of a mountain of cookies. Look how many cookies he's getting.
Jesus Christ, that's a lot of cookies!
And a large hot chocolate.
Too much! Look great, Huckle. Thank you! You're welcome!
People are like, Aaron, is anybody paying? And people are discussing... Oh.
Hi. I would like to have a green salad and some yogurt.
I'm watching my way.
And you know, you can discuss why no one's paying. I think it's because Huckle is...
They all work
stoned.
On the barter system. And yeah, Huckle's too stoned.
Everyone in this entire town is high. This is Austin.
People
and...
keep walking up to him and being like, so should I pay or... No, it's cool. Your money's no good here, man. Just take all the salad and hot dogs. I'm doing this for exposure.
Who was saying thank you and who was saying you're welcome? I think Huckle is saying
Look
you're welcome.
Great, Huckle. Thank you. You're welcome.
Wait, he opens his mouth when it says you're welcome, though.
Who knows?
Hi. I would like to have some strawberries and some bread.
It's called the idiot diet.
I call it deconstructed strawberry shortcake.
Venture pals rushing to the jokes. Wait, no, retro pals.
No.
New name, same old shit. It's so... I guess I like this game because there's no pressure or anything. You can mess up as much as you want and nobody will say nothing to you.
Look great, Huckle. Thank you.
The pile of strawberries is as big as his head. Okay, we're gonna do one more and then we're gonna get the hell out of here. We're gonna skip out on
green. And a green salad.
We put in like an 8-hour work day. We're good. Green salad.
Becomes highly recommended.
Looks great, Huckle. Thank you. You're welcome.
No, we're done. Store's closed. Get out.
Hi. I would like to have some cheese and a glass of milk.
I would like some cheese.
Just get out of here, folks.
We're leaving.
Thank you so much. Goodbye.
Oh my goodness.
Goodbye. It's a very quotable game. You can't help it. Alright, delivery truck, very similar to the fire truck game, but you have more responsibility in this one.
Please deliver to the toy shop!
Everyone's just barely keeping it together. Oh!
Uh-oh!
Yeah, the difference in this one is...
Better slow down now!
Yeah, the cops will be on your ass if you make a mistake.
So this is just... I hate to be like that guy, but Huckle's just stoned, right? This entire game is like just stoned trying to get his, like, life together.
Just what I was expecting. Thanks a lot.
Also, why does Huckle get to drive? I thought he was a little boy, but I guess he's like an adult now or whatever.
Well, this is what we call a crash warp in the speedrunning community. You warp right back to the beginning if you crash. A box of pills, just what I needed.
No, Huckle, please.
I'm gonna take this down to Mexico. Oh man, come on. Oh, you're gonna get on me for that?
Better slow down now.
Say, what's this massive box of pills you're hauling with you? Oh well, it's probably nothing. I'd never seen the box of pills in this game. That's a new one on me. I'm glad that that's the case, though. Oh, dude, there was a crossing guard. You could like run over some kids. That's awful.
Just what I was expecting. Thanks.
We're not gonna do that. We're a family stream. And yeah, this goes on for quite a while until you basically just stop. But if you play the fire truck game instead, you can just run everything over. You don't even have to care.
Thanks for the delivery.
You've taken off 1 hour into your 8-hour shift. But you're my friend, so I can't fire you. Alright, we're almost done with the game. We have a few more attractions left. The only attractions we have left are my favorites.
Yes.
This is great. I love building a house. The wind is excellent.
Richard Scarry's naked lunch.
Hi, Huckle. Hi, Lowly. I'm building a house for the Stitches family.
Cool.
Hi, Jason. Want some help? Great. I'll go get the mortar and bricks with my forklift.
He's not coming back.
We can go up and down to build the chimney.
I'm sorry, these guys can say anything and I'm just losing my shit.
Let's put shingles on the roof.
Wow, what a great use of our time.
You gotta laugh because this is a saga of Huckle's community service.
Are
that
okay?
Makes sense.
Yeah.
Be careful, Huckle.
Oh, Jesus,
this is a town of just getting free labor out of these poor dumb kids. And yeah, you can't hit your thumb if you tap the wrong places.
Are you okay? Be careful, Huckle. Ow!
What? Come on, Huckle!
Are you okay? Be careful, Huckle.
I guess it's...
Ow!
Wait a minute.
Are you okay?
Am I gonna be able to finish this?
Be careful, Huckle.
Okay. There, God.
That's it for the roof!
Yeah.
That's it for the roof! Oh my lord, I'm so sorry that I just...
Here are some things for you to carry into the house.
Oh, you want...
Start with the water heater.
You want me to carry the water heater into the house. I'm a child, sir, but okay.
I'm nine!
That was heavy!
Water faucet. It's a long piece of pipe.
Tell me more about your long piece of pipe.
Maybe I'm not a child. Maybe I am an adult. It's just really hot.
The hot water faucet is next.
Let's just put together the whole house. Save money.
The sink goes upstairs.
you'll get a toilet.
Are you ready for the washing machine?
No! I'm practically dead now. I've been hauling shit around all day.
That was heavy.
The furnace weighs a lot, too.
Well, he's not
too
concerned.
Wow, fuck you!
Let's take it up to the roof.
That was heavy.
This child labor simulator.
Mm-hmm.
Here's the smoke pipe, Huckle.
You know a lot about this.
Let me know if this air duct fits, Huckle.
Well, you could hire a carpenter or a contractor or some sort of independent expert. But sure, just let a kid stick it on.
The green chair is very big.
And very heavy.
That was heavy!
And I could put it up through the basement.
Put the lamp next to the chair.
So I can sit on my fat ass and watch TV all day.
Carry the television carefully, Huckle. It's fragile.
Careful, it's a PVM. Do you like RGB output, Huckle? Oh, it's beautiful.
Let's find out if everything works! Here we go!
Same.
He has just this tinge of hopelessness in his voice when you slow it down a little bit.
I am thirsty.
Push a switch.
Thanks for turning on the water heater.
Whatever, kid. This comes off the other.
I am thirsty.
I wanted to test the hot water, but okay.
This water tastes great. My hands are dirty. I will wash them. My hands are clean.
Jesus, that is ominous.
That's dark. No more blood. Not anymore.
My hands are clean.
Here's an interesting program.
What?
He didn't think so. He did that on his own.
The furnace will warm up the house.
Installed the furnace. Whoa, Huckle.
My shirt is clean!
That's pretty wasteful, Huckle. Well, looks like everything's in working order. Oh shit.
Click on the mouse when Huckle is in front of the object.
Oh!
Wow.
More light makes it easier to read.
Read about my sins!
Here's an interesting program.
Gonna spend the rest of the game watching TV.
Yes. Whose house even is this? Are they ever gonna like?
It's just
know?
A house.
Okay.
We're out of here.
Bye.
There it is. We built an entire house. Just me. Just me, the little kid who's also a cat or something.
What a beautiful house. Bye bye.
Bye.
I didn't want to be paid anyway. This is a busy town. Well, I think it's time to meet our friend.
Captain Salty.
Captain Salty.
Yes.
Without a doubt, the highlight of this game. Here he is. Nothing I can say can introduce Captain Salty, so here he is. He really speaks for himself.
Ahoy, mateys. Let's get this ship put together.
Yes.
Let's get this shit put together.
Love him. I love Captain Salty so much.
The rudder makes the ship turn. The propeller moves the ship through the water.
You built a house, a ship should be no problem for you.
The engine drives the propeller.
Always sounds like he's trailing off.
This big container holds fuel to power the engine.
He sounds like stoned Paul Lind.
We send messages with the radio. The compass gives us our direction.
Building a boat, piece by piece, operating heavy equipment.
Radar helps guide us across the sea.
Captain Salty, I don't even know what radar is. I'm just a child. Wait, no, is this someone else doing the building?
Yeah, you're just watching. He's
the lifeboat is for emergencies.
Lifeboat's for emergencies. Yeah, you're just kind of watching.
That's cool.
We cook our meals on the stove.
The stove.
The flag waves in the breeze.
Everything sounds so sexually suggestive coming from Captain Salty.
It does. It's just because he slowed down, you know?
Waves in the breeze.
Snaggle puts
a member of the crew sleeps in the bed.
There.
Take that again, Captain Salty.
Our ship carries mail in the mail bag.
Mail bag.
Ah, one of those mail ships.
The luggage holds lots of clothes.
Clothes, huh? Oh, now we need the most important thing.
The life preserver will float on the water.
Will float on the water.
You can barely even tell what he's saying. He's just, he's so incoherent.
He's out of it.
Nice work! Here comes the crew!
There goes the crew. Bye. You have to guide them onto the things.
Great place for a nap.
The crew members are my favorite part of this
game.
Oh,
I'm that guy.
I can see everything from up here.
That's good.
Anchors of A, Captain.
I love that guy.
This guy's my favorite.
The rudder moves when I turn the wheel.
That guy is me.
nothing like the flesh sea air.
Nothing like the flesh sea air.
I love the flesh.
The crew likes my cooking.
That guy is also pretty good.
Mm-hmm.
Messages coming in, Captain.
And Salty ship of degenerates.
Engine set! Ready to sail, sir.
Oh my god, Kid Fenris.
What's happening?
Captain Salty, what are you going to eat on your voyage?
Oh man.
Oh no, this is
he
too
does have
dark.
A very he has a very
well done, stuff. Crew. Let's see how things work on our ship. Well done, crew. Now let's get this ship painted. I'm a little painting myself there.
Looks great. Oh, we can paint it. There we go. Now it's a real ship. We did indeed get this shit put together. Captain Salty, I wish you would wash your language around children. Then again, he is named Captain Salty, so... Where are our parents, is the question. Did it. Beautiful.
Aye, aye, Captain. We're ready.
Full steam ahead.
Off on our sinful voyage.
Just the horniest!
It It's hard not to read too much into it when you're playing this edition, especially. It's so innocent when you play it on the Sega Genesis. And alright, it's time to end it by taking control of God, and we are going to terrorize the citizens of Busytown. Prepare yourself for the wind. It's kind of a weird one, because you don't control Huckle, you just
control... Whoa, my kite! Better hold on!
...the wind. And you can be a nice wind god. You can help... Yeah, this music. You can help the kids fly their kites. You can mess with birds. You can screw over this bird. I think it's time to fuck with this guy.
My head! The wind is blowing my head!
Oh no! Sucker.
The wind is so strong today!
You took your hat. Give me that back. Ruin this paper airplane, I think. But you can't make it crash. You also have control over Busytown's overall mood and demeanor.
The wind is so strong today!
So let's turn things dark. No, go back, go back!
No, it doesn't want to be dark and edgy.
No, we're gonna be dark. This is the new dark and edgy Richard Scarry's Busytown.
For the new dark and edgy retro pals. Okay, let it go and I think it'll...
Perfect. Ah, now it looks like a murder's gonna happen.
The wind feels good.
What the fuck?
How good does it feel now?
What are you doing?
Killing a man.
Maybe you shouldn't, but...
Why not?
I can't answer that, really.
Oh no! My boat is sinking!
Mm-hmm.
Oh god!
We killed him! Uh-oh, he escaped.
Danny!
At least we sank his boat.
Every sailor should be a good swimmer.
That's the one lesson I want you all to take away from this. Every sailor should be a good swimmer. And you can't hide from God's wrath. Oh, and there's our friend, a little paper boat. Acting like nothing's wrong. All this music drones on.
Whoa, my kite! Better hold on! My head!
Danny?
Mm-hmm.
The wind is blowing my head!
Can't get it this time. It's gonna go too high. Yep, we did it! We're playing keep away with the poor pig man who decided to go to the park today.
Cursed pig man.
Time to take this hat and throw it into a dumpster. Oh no, this is the worst day of my life! And that's... Clive Barker presents American McGee's Busytown. Highly recommended if you have a Sega Dreamcast. You can get this emulator pretty easily. And there's a whole bunch of games that act very strangely. If you have a favorite for the Sega Genesis, it's worth running it through this emulator just to see it get all dark and twisted, like how Busytown did.
Oh my god.
Actually, I got a minute here.
Got a few.
Are you prepared for true hell?
You know what, I'm not, actually.
Well, we're gonna go to hell.
Alright.
I tried this earlier today. Oh, you may want to turn down the volume a little bit.
Can do.
I started thinking of other games that used voice samples extensively, and one that was on this disc is a little game called Mick and Mac as the Global Gladiators.
Uh-oh.
This theme song, Something You Should Hear. Something You Should Hear. Are you ready?
No.
David Lynch's Busytown. Yeah, basically. It's too good. I'm glad I finally got to share it. That was very gratifying. But in the meantime...
Are you ready? Yeah! Cool! Are you ready? Awesome! Yeah! Ouch!
And that concludes the first half of our program tonight. I don't think we can go anywhere from that. Are you ready, Alex?
I am not ready in the least.
Well, I wasn't sure about how to follow up on Busytown tonight, but I figure if it stuck to one genre specifically, it would be horror. Mm-hmm. So I decided we should fill out tonight's stream with a couple more horror games. We're going to have a brief intermission here in a second, but do stay tuned, because we're going to play Death Crimson 2 and Death Crimson Ox, two sequels to a legendary Kusoge. It's
so good.
Yeah, you're really going to want to see this. In the meantime, over the next 10 minutes, you get to enjoy a cartoon that I had on VHS tape as a kid. This was my exposure to Richard Scarry as a kid. It's, this thing is very cheaply made, as you might be able to tell.
Yes.
Do look out for the animation in this. It's pretty good. We'll see you in 10.
See you, folks.
And we're back.
We are returned.
Take that as a lesson. If you steal 20 cents of flour from the local grocer, the cops will hunt your ass down. Don't think they won't.
Don't.
People of Busytown are petty, man. You don't even know.
They're kind of dicks.
They
kind of
had it in for that wolf. He just wanted to eat some kids. That's...
He's a wolf.
What do you expect?
Yeah.
Anyway, Busytown is now completely over with. I'm happy to say no more Busytown.
No more Busytown.
Instead, we're venturing into even weirder territory with Death Crimson 2.
Oh my gosh.
Oh dear God. I'm going to start up the game in the background here while I explain a few things.
Cool.
Since this does need explaining, just keep an eye on the volume. Oh, by the way, we're playing the Sega Dreamcast. Did you know? So yeah, if you've been watching us for a while, you may have seen us play through the original Death Crimson for the Sega Saturn, a legendary Kusoge among Japanese enthusiasts. It's considered among the worst games ever, just completely incompetent in every way, poorly executed, just so many good stories about that game.
Mm-hmm.
Just to catch you up a little bit in case you're unfamiliar, yeah, this company, Ecole, caught a lot of shit for this game, for the original Death Crimson, that is, to the point where a lot of registration cards came back to the company with the words kill and die scrawled all over
them. Yes!
And they took that to heart for Death Crimson 2. They realized, hey, people kind of like this shitty game, maybe we should make it kind of crappy on purpose. And... yeah, the results are kind of divisive among the Kusoge community. They don't consider Death Crimson 2 to be genuinely a Kusoge. It's rather Bakage, which is something that you... I guess they consider, since they approached it as intentionally being a Kusoge, it can't be a true Kusoge. Something like that. I don't fucking know. Let's go ahead and start the game. See if it lives up to expectations.
To the Kusoge dream here.
Mm-hmm. Densetsu no Kusoge, that's what they call the original Death Crimson. Legendary Kusoge. They call it Death-sama. That's how much they appreciate it.
It is called Death-sama in a
It is a revered game. The question is, how do you follow up on that? Well, let's see. Now, there were a couple of Death Crimson games released for Dreamcast. There was this one, Death Crimson 2, and the sequel, Death Crimson Ox. Which we'll see afterwards. They are very different games.
Very.
The word around the English language internet is basically, oh, Ox is just an improved version of Death Crimson 2. Not
nope.
So. Not in the least. Death Crimson 2 is its own beast, and it's very rarely seen, so I'm happy to show it off here tonight. Feel free to adjust the audio as necessary.
Yeah, and once again, let us know if we need to adjust the audio. Yeah, now that we're using a new program, we can do that. It's great.
Ah, Death Crimson 2.
Oh, that...
Launching off with a similar cheesy synth as in the first game. Keeping up standards.
This is so much more... Oh, gosh.
So, among the things the original Death Crimson is known for is its protagonist, whose name is Echizen. His code name is Combat Echizen. And he makes a return in this game.
Finally.
As many series fans will be happy to see. There's also a whole bunch of new characters, though.
Really? Like who?
Like Yuri Rosenberg.
Oh!
You know, this intro's new to me. I've never seen it. I'm gonna watch it.
Okay, let's do it. Fine!
Maybe this will help me understand the story. I have been researching the story, by the way. It's... What?
That's me!
The squirrel?
Yes.
Experience, evolution, karma. Dreamcast making pain sounds as it loads the scene. I hope you can hear it through the mic. Dreamcast, a famously loud system. There it comes, the squirrel.
It's me.
Squirrel also returns from the original Death Crimson. If you remember, there were flying squirrels in the game that you couldn't shoot or you'd lose life. This game is basically a love letter to everyone who loved the original Death Crimson, so no one. Take that for whatever it means to you. It's a love letter to no one. Death Crimson 2. Death Crimson 2. So before we get the story started, I'll catch you up a little bit. One of the things that stuck out about the original game is that the protagonist, Combat Echizen, is shown as this hardcore soldier guy, but for some reason they gave him like a whiny teenager voice, so he's always all like, "Ew, I don't want to go," stuff like that. Happy to say, he returns to narrate Death Crimson 2.
Oh, it's so good.
This intro just... Oh my god.
No, I'm putting away. Yeah, there we go. Gotta listen.
Watch out for sound, because it maxes out at one point.
Okay.
There's our whiny boy Echizen.
He's even whinier.
Yep, he's stepping it up. That's Danny.
Oh, hi.
We're in Castle Danny. But Danny's been imprisoned in his own dungeon. Look at this guy.
おのれの城の牢獄に閉じ込められる気分はどうだ。エメラルドをお前が持っているはずだ。そのエメラルドとともに国もゾンがあったはずだ。今日が最後の日。暴れな男よ。その苦しみから解放してやろう。さらばだ、ダニー君。ダニー君。
Oh shit, watch this. What
happened?
Holy
shit! Glad I had the audio adjusted down.
Yep. Combat Echizen! So it's been 20 years after the events of the first Death Crimson. Combat Echizen is gone missing. And in the meantime, a resistance has sprung up to fight this evil corporation or something? It's a little bit more fleshed out in the sequel. Partly because it's in English. But as you can see here...
Hot and cold!
They added actual backgrounds, actual character models, voice acting, and actual gameplay.
That's amazing. And hot and cold.
Yeah. Hot and cold. Now, I'm not going to show all the dialogue sequences, but I'll show you a bit of this one just to give you an idea of how it plays out. This is the way it handles cutscenes. It shows characters zoomed in, and instead of showing actions, it just plays like sound effects. Door opens. Enter this guy.
Oh my god.
It's Greg, the professor at the university.
Fucking Greg.
This is the elusive Lily, who's in charge of the resistance group.
That dude's mouthful.
Yeah, but it moves.
It's awful. It's like
he's got fingers even.
It's like he's suckling something invisible. I hate it.
Eating an invisible sausage.
Yeah, he does look like Eggman. Like, he looks like David Lynch's Eggman.
There's the famed red door from the intro of the first game. Basically, anything that became a meme from the first game, they incorporated into this one. It's pure fan service for anyone who played that shit game.
That lens flare and pre-rendered background, though, is just divine.
Lens flare completely unmodified, it's just there. So these scenes go on forever. There is so much dialogue in this game, I can't believe it. Hey, it's me. Who are you? And yeah, there's dialogue choices. There's branching dialogue decisions before the game has even begun. And yeah, if you want to dig into the story of Death Crimson, there's a lot here. There's a lot here. So long, so much it takes a really long time to skip all the way through it.
Oh my god, it does.
What? So it's much more technically competent, but still very rough. Still very, very rough. And it still maintains that flavor of the first game, that kind of hastily put together charm, I guess you could call it. Lily! This is Martha. Martha has a troll face. Looks like some kind of goblin. Where's the... Okay, you can hold the left trigger to skip through it. It's good. I do want to get to the gameplay, because there is gameplay. And if you're familiar with Death Crimson Ox, which was released in the States, you'll notice this is completely different.
Mm-hmm.
None of this is in the sequel whatsoever. God, it's still going. Gotta find the goblin antidote.
Too many people turning into goblins. Please.
Do we finally get to play? I think we might. You ready for this? What does this game play like? First game was a light gun shooter. Oh no.
What?
Who keeps shooting this woman in front of me?
Just please knock it off!
And here it is. Yep. It's a light gun shooter. It does have support for light guns, but you can play with the D-pad. And as you can see this time around, it looks way better than the first game. They obviously took some cues from Sega's House of the Dead 2 in particular. It's like they looked at that game and thought, oh, that's how you make a game. All right. Just needed some guidance. So we have experience, we have karma, we have an evolution meter.
No.
Oh my god. And yeah, straight up scenes ripped out of House of the Dead 2.
Grandma's save Martha. Neo from the Matrix.
She was. Also note for now how delicately this game is mixed. Note how soft the bullet sounds and the voices are. Just keep that in mind for later. Naturally, it's pretty hard to play with a controller, but we're making do.
Yeah, it's my first time seeing this game too, and it's
really something, yeah.
Yeah, it is. I have such a soft spot for Ecole.
Mm-hmm.
Yurikai, soyomasu. Da.
Ecole, the company who made this, later went on to find greater fame with the Melty Blood series.
Yes, they did.
Yep, they developed Melty Blood, the people who made Death Crimson.
They're classic trash masters, let's just be honest.
Mm-hmm. Dear God, it just keeps going. They recorded a lot of dialogue for this game. So what we're going to see here in a minute is that this isn't just a light gun shooter. There's a little bit more to this. Oh my god!
No!
Same. Oh man. Go back to Sonic Adventure, lady. These all kind of look like Sonic Adventure human models. So hopefully what we'll see here soon is a shift in gameplay style. It turns out, it's also Resident Evil!
Oh my god!
Yep! They did it! They turned Death Crimson into Resident Evil. It is straight-up tank controls, a third-person action-adventure-y sort of thing. Though it stops you a lot so the character can talk to herself. And later on, it does become full-on Resident Evil, full of nonsensical puzzles and stuff you gotta solve through various means. I'm explaining this in very general terms because I haven't played much of this. I have played enough to get to this part, and I was just amazed that it became Resident Evil. Again, this is something that doesn't happen at all in Death Crimson Ox. Not whatsoever. It's a straight-up light gun game. I'll elaborate on that in a little bit. I have been reading up on these games, believe it or not. I did go to the Japanese Kusoge Wiki and see what they had to say about it.
As we do.
So there's something you gotta do here. Something you gotta look at, probably. Maybe a door you gotta go into. Controls aren't great. The camera swings around wildly. You can barely control it. Hey, it's Pat. This guy's a jerk. And yeah, so it goes. You go through a kind of crappy, scaled back Resident Evil style game in between the light gun segments.
Hooray!
Is it you have to... What is that?
Mwah mwah!
That's... Yeah, it's a giant pair of lips!
It's Cyber Lip Egg!
Oh, I looked at it and got some life.
Cyber Lip Egg is lucky.
What is this game, Alex? I clearly need to play more of it, but I'm just fascinated at how they fleshed out this completely crappy game. I remember what happens now. Eventually, Jesus, camera! Eventually you get locked in this room, and it gives you 10 minutes to try and figure out how to escape. Spoilers, I never figured out how. I slowly died.
That's no good.
There's some sort of combination of things you have to examine in order to escape, I think. Didn't figure it out, but by now I think you get the idea. We'll move on to the next game in the series after this, but there's one more thing I want to show off. One more defining feature of this game that I discovered literally yesterday. Oh man, this will be fun to try and work on the fly here. So in addition to the story mode, you can also play mission mode, which is just straight up light gun sequences. You don't have to go through any of the story stuff. There are a few interesting options in this game. One, I had to translate through the Kusoge wiki like 3 or 4 times to make sure it was actually saying what I thought it said. And yeah, it turns out I was correct. This is a thing that's in the game. Instead of explaining it, I'm just going to go ahead and do it.
I was going to say, should I mute the mic so it can be a surprise, or...
What do you think?
We're going to let this be a surprise. Let us do a minute here of setup, and okay. We'll show you something pretty good here. We'll be right back.
All right, let's see if this worked. This is a very unconventional option. I had to make triple sure, but the Kusoge wiki told me this game has Dreamcast microphone support. I literally can't believe this is a thing. Let's go ahead and just start up a game here.
FMV Dog, we actually did play Papara Pion on one of our streams, and I think it's on our YouTube, isn't it?
It should be, yeah. Yeah, Eccles' other Sega Saturn game. An excellent puzzler.
Actually not bad, especially compared to Death Room. Okay, this looks like fun.
What up, YouTube? It's time for some gape. So yeah, you can record your own hit noises in this game. You can record up to 3. It gives you a total of 3 seconds to record up to 3 clips, so I just chose to record 2. One of which, in case you can't make it out, is... It's time for some game theory. The second of which is, what up, YouTube? Comes through in crystal clear audio.
You gotta turn it up a little.
What up, YouTube?
Okay.
It's time for some game theory. What up, YouTube? Time for some game theory. What up, YouTube? It's time for some game theory. What up, YouTube?
Yes, I gotta say, rarely seen feature in video games. The only other game I can think of that has something similar is, what was that DS Star Fox game? Star Fox Command? You could input your voice, and it would be the animal babbling through the whole game.
I just keep hearing it's time for some game theory and what up, YouTube in my headphones, and I'm...
Yeah. There's also a bunch of different character voices you can give your main character here. You can give him an anime lady's voice, and she's all like, "Stop!" and "Oh, you're mean."
Mm-hmm.
But recording your own really is the true gem of this game. Why did they do that? Why is that an option? That's so great. And why don't more games do it? I also think it's interesting that they give you two different bitrate options, which makes the sounds a little bit less clear, but it takes up less space on a memory card if you save it. Yeah, that's Death Crimson 2. In addition to having a truly excellent option in letting you record your own hit noises, it's also a very lengthy adventure game. Mixed with a light gun game. There's clearly more ground to be explored here, but that's about the limits of my knowledge on Death Crimson 2. Let's move on to the third and thus far final game in the series, Death Crimson Ox. So what'd you think, Alex?
I couldn't keep myself together during that segment, so I think that explains it.
It's a hit, good. So as we mentioned during our last Death Crimson stream, at the end of the Sega Dreamcast life, American Sammy had one more game they were set to publish here in the States. They had a choice. They could either localize Death Crimson Ox, sequel to the game you just saw, or they could have localized Guilty Gear X. They chose Death Crimson Ox. And pay attention to that screen. It is super, super flashy. If you're sensitive to that kind of thing, do be aware.
Yeah, either y'all can, I am too, so just y'all can look away. Or if any of y'all it's bugging you, we will, we're able to turn down the brightness and things like that. So
yeah.
If it is to you. But take care, folks.
And yeah, you see, this is in English. They did indeed release this in the States.
I can't believe this.
I have a retail copy of Death Crimson Ox for the Sega Dreamcast. By the way, if you're silently raging at me for saying Death Crimson Ox instead of OX...
It's Ox.
I looked it up. It's the Japanese name is Death Crimson Okusu. So it is literally Ox. Believe it or not. What does that have to do with the game? Nothing, as far as I can tell. It's just called Death Crimson Ox. So with that in mind, let's start her up. Wonder if this one has an intro, too. Same intro.
Oh, that good intro.
Now this game, from what I can tell, the Kusoge Wiki refused to acknowledge that this was either a Bakugei or a Kusoge. They said, no, this is just a normal game you can enjoy on your own. And they criticized it for that, saying that it lost some of that distinctive flavor of the Death Crimson series. Because this is an actual playable game. It's okay.
It's a real game.
Okay, pay attention to this storyline.
Okay. Oh no!
A group of mutants called the Subliminers have taken over this town, and there's a resistance fighting against the SMO. The leader is Lily, an enigmatic woman who cooks a mean macaroni and cheese dish. Pay attention, that's important.
Okay.
Anyway, this one guy betrayed the SMO and he took the Crimson Guns, right? And he teamed up with Lily's daughter, who is searching for Lily because she was kidnapped by the SMO.
Okay.
But be careful of the Subliminers, because they shall be shot with the Crimson.
Okay.
The challenge to me tonight is to actually pay attention to the story, because I've never been able to keep heads or tails of it.
I still don't know what... Okay.
I'm actually going to look at the manual here, because the manual is a treasure trove of English language Death Crimson information.
It
outlines the whole story, and more importantly, it outlines all the different characters. They do profile our good friend Kosuke Echizen. Here, they've given him the new name Combat Panther, because Combat Echizen was apparently too stupid even for the US manual. And if you remember the intro text specifically, check out Echizen's profile here. I'm reading from the manual. His favorite food is mean macaroni and cheese dish. That's the first line of his bio.
I just love mean macaroni and cheese. Just please.
Yeah, if you thought that was just a throwaway bit of 90s sass in the intro, no, it's actually plot important. This one lady can cook a mean macaroni and cheese. And you know who likes mean macaroni and cheese? Combat Echizen. His bio goes on to say he was supposed to have obtained the Crimson, but his whereabouts are presently unknown. So in this game, he's also a non-presence. Should also mention, this was an arcade game. This was ported to Naomi hardware, and you could play this in Japanese arcades. I don't think it got an American release, which is a shame, but it did get a release on the American Dreamcast. I'm gonna start it up. Oh, we're making good on time. Alright. I also found out earlier today, this game has a really easy free play mode, which I just entered the code for. Super easy, you just hold X and Y on the title screen and push start, and you have unlimited credits. Let's see how far we can get into old Oxy here.
Oxy?
Good old Oxy. Yeah, that looks good. Unfortunately, this game does not have that option to record your own damage sound effects. Really unfortunate. So among the many changes made between Death Crimson 2 and Death Crimson Ox is this basically being a completely different game? Like, it uses all the same environment art, the character models, really all the graphical elements from Death Crimson 2. but it repurposes them to be a completely different storyline and progression and different levels and stuff. And later on in the game, someone, at least in the Japanese ones, one of the characters explicitly says this is a side story to what happened in Death Crimson 2. It's like an alternate universe thing.
Oh, that's so cool.
So as they said in the intro, very flashy. It flashes a very bright light every time you hit an enemy. Pretty annoying. I wish they didn't do that, honestly. But even more so than Death Crimson 2, this looks more like a real game. So much so, I guess it probably disappointed Death Crimson fans who were expecting something much crappier than this. But this is so playable. Like, it's not amazing or anything, but, you know, you can shoot things, you can aim the reticle with no problem. As the Kusoge Wiki said, it said you could play it normally. That was their biggest complaint against this game. The game doesn't interfere with you trying to play it. It's also much more balanced in terms of gameplay, and, oh yeah, there's no voices. I'm pretty sure there's no voices in the Japanese version either. Which seems kind of weird after the major voice acting cast of Death Crimson 2. Hey, skeletons! Who are made of glass.
Beautiful.
Yeah. This is honestly some good shit right here. You can enjoy this game. This game also fixed a major problem. Oh my god, loud. Super loud.
Yeah, let us know if we need to adjust the audio in any way, folks.
It may just be too loud on our end, that's it.
Okay.
So unlike Death Crimson 2, in these scenes, it actually gives you a little bit of invincibility after you take a hit. Death Crimson 2 gave you none of that, and there were scenes where, like, six dudes will shoot you at the same time, and you'll take damage from all six of them. Real cool stuff. But here, they had the audacity to turn this into a real game, and honestly, I'm not sure how I feel about that. Because, like, it's still stupid. Don't get me wrong, it's still really stupid. Like, for instance, this guy here. Sword the Stink. Seriously. That's me, Sword the Stink. That's
sword
what they called me back
stink.
In college. Because I collected samurai swords and I stank.
I never bathed.
Now this scene here is like straight out of House of the Dead 2, the first boss especially. He doesn't have that little guy flying around, but otherwise it's just a big dude with a sword, and he's named Sword the Stink.
Just Sword the Stink.
Sword the Stink.
Sword the Stink. This sword smells terrible.
Mm-hmm. The smelliest sword.
In college I would just watch Cutlery Corner for hours and hours. Not bathing
and ordering every katana I possibly could. Don't know why they kicked me out of the dorm. Sorry, Sword the Stink. It was for this crimson that they kidnapped Lily.
This music!
Should also note this was also released on PS2. The only difference I could see is in the stage clear part that you just saw. In the PS2 version, it would show a looping fire gif on the bottom of the screen, straight out of GeoCities.
Oh, that's so good.
It's really good looking. Otherwise, it's pretty much identical. And that PS2 version was actually released in Europe later on under the title Guncom 2. There was never a Guncom 1. Death Crimson is very mysterious. Oh man, I missed a whole bunch of dialogue. Well, so much for keeping track of the story. No problem, we'll shoot them all with Crimson.
As actually, funny you should mention the rainbow text and stuff, cool parody info. We'll get more into that kind of ties into some one of their later games we'll talk about when we're...
That may have been an intentional gay pride thing, actually, come to think of it.
Actually, yes!
Way back when, during our original Death Crimson stream, we mentioned Ecole entered an experimental period between the Dreamcast era and when they released Melty Blood. And at that time, they established a spin-off studio called Gizmo, who, as it turns out, was dedicated to the production of gay visual novels, like straight-up gay porn visual novels.
Yeah, and not just boy love, but definite, like, just...
It was gay porn for gay dudes. Like.
Yeah, it's like, I'd show off the image, but you're in the middle of gaming.
Yeah, let's wait till a stage clear.
But yeah, you can find... The game was called Cox Bax.
That's spelled COXBAX, if you're
and
curious.
We're gonna ask you, you can...
Don't Google this at work.
Don't Google this at work. Also... Well, we'll show off some safe for work images and whatnot. Please, if you Google this, if you can, and find the images, please don't share with chat. There's very few that aren't not porn.
One of the good things about the modern internet is that all the CG images from Coxbacks have been preserved on the internet. Just look for Gizmo Coxbacks, you'll find them.
No, I wouldn't call it Bara either. It's just, I can't describe. It just feels like...
It's not with big burly dudes, it's... I don't know.
It's hard to describe. I guess it's just... It just feels like a gay game by a guy who really liked to...
It felt like a labor of love.
Yeah, it actually, like, the art, like, Oliver Cole stuff is not... Or Ecole stuff is not good, like, in a lot of ways. But there's a lot of artistic things that definitely are... I like it. I think it's...
They're a weird company, and they branched out in unexpected directions, and I respect them for that. What other company could make Death Crimson and also gay porn?
And Melty Blood!
And Melty Blood!
Like, exactly! I kind of love these garbage
Seriously.
People! Like, I do, and...
We need more companies like these guys. Now, there has been a webpage for a long time teasing Death Crimson 3. They said it has entered production to some extent, but there's never been any updates on its development or anything. Hopefully someday they'll finish it up. Just telling you guys, PlayStation VR, money's right there on the table. You just gotta take it. Hell, port this to the PS4.
I'd play it.
I would, yeah.
That's a horrible noise.
Those were teddy bears? Think? I've already completely lost track of this game. I said I was gonna keep track of the story, but that's gone out the window. Ultra Crimson.
Some safe images, but like let's keep that to a minimum so we got.
You run the risk of seeing a lot of things on Coxbax's website.
You run the risk of Twitch cops being like, someone said Coxbax?
That's not on the banned games list. We could play it.
I saw some of those images.
We probably couldn't play it. No.
We would be absolutely hell banned.
Surprising lot of water sports in that game.
Yeah.
Not for Twitch.
So, this game, huh?
Ooh, machine gun.
Oh, yeah, machine gun.
I forget, you can also charge up your weapon in this game, which gives you the ability to shoot off shots, like, automatically. It's kind of strange. Like, you charge up and it just unleashes, like, 20 shots in a row.
Okay. I'm sorry, I went to look at the image that was added in chat, and I clicked on the wrong tab, and then I was expecting just gay intimacy, and instead it's a picture of macaroni and cheese. Of all things, both of those relate to what we're discussing, so there you go.
Wait. Read that. Read the bottom of the screen. Am I seeing that correctly? The backup ball tracery will not attack until it radiates.
Absolutely.
Okay, we gotta wait and shoot.
Yeah, wait for the ball tracery.
Okay, waiting did nothing. It just got me hit. Still, the weirdly stilted English in this game, it honestly feels kind of intentional to me after reading the manual, because everything is... Just the vocabulary they use, everything is stated just so. Just so it sounds acceptable, like, on a first reading, but they use strange words to express concepts. I don't know how to explain it. It's just very Death Crimson-y. Take my word for it. But suffice to say, whoever was in charge of the US localization, I think they were in on the joke, because it's very well translated. Oh no, that's a sound effect. Number of killings. It's just phrased so perfectly.
It's so good! It's so good!
That's what I think of as a Death Crimson kind of phrase there. Oh, this guy got an upgrade. He looks better in this one.
Oh, he does!
Maybe because he's not moving his mouth. What is the deal with this gun?
What's the deal with weaponry?
Yuri, by the way, is a student at the university, and that's a professor who was expelled from the university after speaking out against SMO. He has since joined the radical resistance. That scene right there, we were walking around it in the Resident Evil part a few minutes ago. These glass skeletons. I love them.
Yay, macaroni and cheese, everybody. That's chat right now.
Excellent. Everyone is gay for macaroni and cheese. Especially mean macaroni and cheese. That skeleton just kicked me in the head!
What the fuck?
Look at these kung fu skeletons! That's great! Oh, man.
Everybody!
I love this game. Crimson.
Oh, that's good! That's good!
Oh, they're talking about Combat Echizen. Are we gonna meet him? Okay, now I gotta keep playing this game.
Okay.
I'm invested. Subliminers! They're called subliminers, Alex. What? And once again, this was released in the States and not Guilty Gear X. Sure, it was eventually released for the PS2, but we could have had it on Dreamcast. The cool people's system. Other things I guess I should mention, they trimmed down a lot of the meters that were in Death Crimson 2. There's no karma meter or whatever the other one was. There's still an experience meter, which fills up as you shoot enemies, and I think it actually depletes as you miss shots. If it fills up all the way, you get an extra life, and it also somehow figures into something called crazy mode, which is something you enter if you're if you only have one life left.
Mm. So what happens if you shoot a civilian gun?
I don't know. I haven't tried it yet.
You should shoot one.
Okay.
Everyone's demanding you do.
Let's do it.
By everyone, I mean.
That's a good idea, though.
I mean, someone else and also me. Definitely.
It's a good idea, because in the first game, you'll remember, when you shoot civilians, your character just goes, oh no!
Same.
Okay, so the Crimson has to be used by the Chosen Party, aka Combat Echizen.
Okay, he goes, oh my god!
That was good. Music's pretty good, though.
It is, yeah.
By the way, if you see these knives flying from some of these enemies, I enjoy how they fly horizontally instead of just going directly at you. They just kind of spin. Oh,
Oh my god!
Cool Coyote asks if Crimson is just mac and cheese.
It could be. Yeah, maybe Echizen exiled himself so he could live a life of just eating mac and cheese every day. Which, can you blame him? Look what's going on in the city. No mac and cheese in sight. Perfect. I enjoy these parts.
Mm-hmm.
These would be kind of fun with an actual light gun. I love it.
I do too.
Now, this isn't a great gun game. There's only, like, one extra weapon you can pick up, and it's this machine gun. There's not much depth. Everything just moves kind of abruptly. Everything seems to be moving too fast. But, you know, it's playable. More than you could say for the first game. I'm just gonna shoot all the civilians from now on. And if you look in the manual, you'll figure out this game actually has a really in-depth scoring system, believe it or not. It's based on this rank that increases in the background as you play. It's reflected in the, that number underneath the experience meter in the upper left. That tells you your rank and your current multiplier. It increases as you make more hits and as you basically just increase the rank. And it decreases when you take hits. There's even more details in the manual. It starts going into detail about coefficients, and that's when I just kind of glazed over. Like, it literally says, in order to get the high scores, you must master the coefficients.
Oh, that's so good!
And I'm like, sorry,
I
no. I don't want to be a calculus major just to play Death Crimson Ox. Here's our next boss. The nice lady from Hot Topic. So far, all she can do is flip. You're just ordinary people. Oh no, she's got the skeleton kicks. Chill out. There we go.
Oh, that's so good.
Good animation. Yeah, go find Echizen. Wow, rank H. That's bad.
It's not good, Danny.
That's worse than F. Worse than G, even. Okay, we found an airplane. Hey, there's the whiny guy from Death Crimson 2.
Oh, good!
Apparently these characters all have completely different personalities and backstories and stuff for this game. But it just became common knowledge here in the West that Death Crimson 2 and this were the same game, and they're not. They're really not. I really wish people would look into Death Crimson 2 some more, because there's a lot to talk about there.
Yeah, there really is.
If I have to play through it myself, so help me God, I might actually have to. You crook. I hear you call me a crook. You deserve to die.
Oh my god, Danny, no, calm down.
I'm not hitting all those. No way. Too many enemies. I'm sorry. Ooh, sorry, I shouldn't have farted directly into the microphone.
I was gonna say, who's farting?
Oh, we lost them. What? What happened? What plane? What plane? Where'd it go? Huh? This game's plot is just...
This game is beautiful!
Wow, it's a rapid-fire, non-stop thrill ride. You put this in the theater, this will be more entertaining than Assassin's Creed. That's the problem with video game movies, they're all boring. I've never understood that. Why would you license a video game and then just make something that's so completely boring to watch, like pretty much anything? Assassin's Creed, Alone in the Dark, god, that was boring.
You know what Alone in the Dark and Assassin's Creed, well, I haven't seen Assassin's Creed, but I'm assuming it doesn't have it. Mean Mac and Cheese.
No, yeah, they don't. This game does. What is going on here?
Actually, have you eaten any mac and cheese in the game?
Not yet, no. We are about to beat Meat Combat Echizen, though.
Oh, good.
Meet and beat him. For mac and cheese.
Go through my labyrinth and defeat me for my sacred mac and cheese.
He's hiding a secret recipe.
For
the meanest mac and cheese.
This ain't your mama's sacred mac and cheese. Whatever. Oh god, some Guy Fieri style.
He's gonna post it on one of those obnoxious recipe blogs where they spend like 10 paragraphs talking about when they first cooked it.
They talk about like their family.
I first got the crimson in 2012 and had the best mac and cheese of my life. I don't know. Oh, that's... Huh? What just happened?
You did quite a number of killings, honey.
I've done better. It was over 100 last level. We should be able to get through the whole thing tonight. I think the whole game runs about half an hour. So we should be pretty close to the end.
Arnold, remember, we don't know what's going on in the game either.
Yeah, I lost track.
Remember, you're like, I'm gonna pay attention. And guess what? We didn't. It still doesn't make sense.
I tried.
Yeah.
The dialogue scrolls really fast. And also doesn't make any sense in the first place.
These glass skeletons!
Kung Fu glass skeletons. How you gonna tell me this game is shit? This can't be shit. Subliminars were originally humans. Oh, that's why they attacked that town, so they could make more subliminars.
I don't know if you noticed, but in that image, in that little scroll, when they were pan up from the knees to the head, knees look like a dog's face.
Good.
I'm gonna highlight that in the...
Yeah, highlight that in the archive.
Because I swear to God, I've seen it like 3 times and I'm like,
look at that dog's face.
Just that beautiful dog's face.
Finally, I find you. Lily's dead. Aww.
Wait, did Lily make the mac and cheese?
No.
Or did I? I mean,
it was Yui.
Yui, okay. I just want to make sure that the mac and cheese is okay.
Lots of words are being said, but not in any combination that I can decipher. Ah, right, the death tracery. What the hell is this thing, Alex? I know it's the death tracery.
It's a It's killing you, but
it's very good at killing me, yeah. What drains its health? I drained a little bit of it. Is it just these little things?
I think so.
Oh, I see. You shoot them while they're charging up. Okay. Got it.
Good.
Did it... Did it go into a cutscene while the continue counter was running?
Yeah.
It sure did.
I love this game, I'm sorry.
Who's powering the lawnmower? Turn that off, we're trying to stream here.
Was the orb yelling? Yes it was. It's going, ah!
The orb was yelling and now it's making... Whatever noise it's making, the Dreamcast is trying to play it 5 times on top of itself, so it's being overdriven to hell. The sound. It's a little kid in a Power Wheels car or something making noises with his mouth. Fight goes on forever, too.
Someone's given the biggest raspberry to the body.
Yeah, quit. Stop it. Oh, this sounds great. Sounds like you're sawing through concrete.
Hey, hold your crimson.
What is with the sound in this game?
It's good. I don't know what
I got
you're
an
talking
F.
about, but it's very good.
An F is an improvement.
Is it? F's, I thought...
It stands for fantastic.
Okay, I believe you.
I just wonder how low the rank goes. Like, does it go to J or M?
Goes to Z.
Echizen.
What the? Oh no!
We're fighting him. We gotta shoot him in the elbow.
Wait a minute, look at him. He's got that lip thing on his head. He's got head
he
egg.
He does! He does!
He's got head egg!
We saw that!
Cyber head lip egg! I just...
Go back to Death Crimson 2 in the archive if you're watching this. It's totally in there.
Oh, that's so good.
Oh, of all the things to reference from Death Crimson 2. I also like that the weak point sometimes appears right on his dick. Or on his elbows.
His weak, weak boner.
There it is. Right in the dick. If you shoot him in the dick, he headbutts you with his giant head. Look at this.
He does!
Well, oh my god, Alex. Welcome to hell.
Games are good again, baby.
It's 2017 and games are fun again.
Oh my gosh.
I found a good one. I never knew what to think of this game, but I think it's finally winning me over. This
it's
may
good.
Be one of my favorite Dreamcast games. We gotta release ourselves from the curse, and now we're in a cave. I really don't know what to think of the changes to the aesthetic from Death Crimson 2, though. They made it much flashier, the screen shakes a lot. It's, I don't know.
Yeah.
I'm of two minds about it. It does look a little bit visually nicer, it pops a little bit more, but I think they went a little overboard. Oh, here's Sword the Stink again.
Oh, good. I
Yes. Let's seal up those accursed guns so they will never create tragedy.
This audio's from Death Crimson.
Is it?
From the original, listen to it.
Like the intro?
Yeah!
Yeah!
Of the Saturn one.
Professor Greg? Is he gonna betray us? Oh my god, he is.
Greg, no!
Greg was that guy all along. What? You gave us fake crimsons?
Oh god.
This game is just... it has the best sound effects. Consistently.
Oh, nice!
I'm going to kill that monster.
With my gun!
This is Professor Greg, the traitor.
The supremacy says this is what happens when you screw a professor out of tenure.
It's true.
It is.
You give them no choice. They gotta transform into a giant beast.
Should have had a union, dude.
I've never actually played this with a light gun. I kind of want to now, because it would be way easier. There's a lot of parts where the game demands that you sweep from the left to the right side of the screen very quickly. Not so great on a controller. Though you can adjust the speed of the reticle. I had to do that.
Okay.
Now we're somewhere else.
Good!
That's over with.
Yes,
oh man.
Back.
Here they are.
Kung Fu Blastout Tunes is a 90s TV show.
Okay, my life meter's flashing, which means I'm in crazy mode. But I don't feel so crazy. It just looks like normal Death Crimson. We're at the boss gauntlet. We're pretty clearly near the end here. How's the story gonna shake out, though? Actually, where can the story go from here? We killed Professor Greg.
Mm-hmm.
Lily's dead. What about the SMO?
Or
whatever it was.
Or the mac and cheese.
Or the mac and cheese. Will the mac and cheese be the MacGuffin that saves the day? That's just what I'm assuming here. People all along. What is camera? Stop. Now, this
Yikes.
Is obnoxious.
Yeah, this is a flashy segment. Y'all,
I like the beginning when the camera was just kind of spinning around like your character was drunk or something. It's doing it again, look, he's just kind of weaving. Maybe he's just so frightening you can't keep your composure. That, and it's flashing like a disco in here.
The disco case,
definitely. Mm-hmm. Jesus, the challenge is to aim while the camera is constantly moving. That's pretty creative, I guess. Not really a fun challenge. Doesn't so much as test your marksmanship as your ability to not get sick. Oh, what a symphony of noise that was.
God damn it, Greg!
Yep! There's the reference! There's the reference to the first game about the red door.
Oh, good.
Direct reference to something Combat Echizen said in the first game. That line about the red door. We explained it in our Death Crimson 1 stream. I think.
I think we did.
We probably did.
Okay.
This is the final boss fight, though. It's not bad. It's pretty tense. Or would be if I had limited credits. One thing's for sure, I want the soundtrack.
Yes.
On vinyl.
All that sleazy sax and everything.
Mm-hmm. this might take a while. And again, we're doing good damage here. Oh. The way it just bounces around the screen. It doesn't weigh anything. It's just a big balloon. There we go.
Okay,
we're doing it.
Thing.
Didn't the last boss in the original Death Crimson take us forever?
I don't remember, but probably.
It seemed like it would never end. We did get through that game, somehow. There we go, that's how you do it. Oops. Commentary, I thought I died, so I tried to push the start button to continue. I just assumed I was dead. Moving on. Let's beat this game. Play this in an arcade. Imagine how cool that would be. Playing Death Crimson Ox. Here we go, here we go.
Nope.
We're gonna do it.
Almost. Oh my god.
The camera spins around
in
a circle while you're trying to aim at this guy, which is what made it so difficult. But we got him. Stage clear. Rank H.
Okay.
All right, let's see how this story concludes. I have no idea. Our crimsons are disappearing.
Is it mac and cheese?
Mac and cheese. Because humans have a desire to hold a gun and shoot. Oh, that's good. As long as humans have a twisted desire for guns, Crimson will continue.
Crimson forever.
That is Death Crimson Ox.
Oh,
a rollicking
God.
Thrill ride of a light gun shooter by Melty Blood developer Ecole. Good stuff. Good stuff.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah, I could see how that would have mixed reactions within the Kusoge community. It feels kind of like a betrayal for them to make an actual game.
Mm-hmm.
An actual playable game that you can finish from beginning to end and not feel complete misery, as you might feel with the first game. It's also kind of a step back from Death Crimson 2, which I really want to dig into more. Like, there's so much depth there, probably, that no one really knows about. Special thanks to Crimsoners.
Aww.
And Naomi-chan.
Thanks, Naomi-chan. I think I'm a Crimsoner.
Yeah.
I'm a fan.
Wait,
fan
that was
Crimson.
That was like 8 people.
What?
Is that the entire staff?
Honestly, probably.
Yeah, yeah. This game might have been made with a skeleton crew, just using the assets from Death Crimson 2.
Oh, buddy.
I feel like a better person for having played through that.
Oh, put it in
that
your
was
name.
A good experience. There we go.
Yeah. Absolutely terrible.
And remember, as long as humans have a twisted desire for guns, Crimson forever. That's Death Crimson Ox. We have now played through 2 of the 3 Death Crimson games on stream. Someday I will go back to Death Crimson 2, maybe try and piece together a walkthrough, assuming the game's not like 8 hours long or something, which it might be. But yeah, I'll get back to you. We have not seen the last of Death Crimson. We will wring every bit of blood out of this game we can.
Crimson and death that we can. Also, the image I promised you earlier, here it is.
Oh yeah, one of the few work-safe images from that game we talked about earlier, Coxbax.
And here's the other one.
Yep. Is that pornographic? You tell me.
I can't tell. Maybe it is, maybe it ain't.
Is there something going on there?
Or is it just an explosion? We don't know.
Is he just opening the Ark of the Covenant in front of his dick? That's my theory. You don't see the other side of the camera there. There's like a Nazi's face melting on the other side.
Oh, thank God. Oh, I guess Crimson Forever.
Yep, another chapter in one of our favorite developers' history, Ecole. Ecole Forever. Weirdly, we still haven't seen all their Dreamcast games. We still have to cover Musepe's Choco Marker, which is puzzler spin-off of Death Crimson starring the flying squirrel from the second game.
Oh, good, my buddy!
It sounds like I was making that up on the fly, but no, that's completely
I'm
true.
So happy.
I still have to get a copy of that game.
Oh my god.
Death Crimson, man. Good times. What a way to start off the year, and what a way to start off the Retro Pals.
Yeah.
With Death Crimson. Thanks for watching. We're Retro Pals. We do this every Wednesday at 7 p.m. Central. If you like what we do, check us out on Patreon. If you pitch in a few bucks every month, you get to vote for what we play. This week, people wanted to see Clive Barker's Busytown, and boy, did they ever.
Thank you for that,
and
by the way.
No matter what you think of that, hopefully I made up for it with Death Crimson later on. This was a pretty solid stream overall, in my opinion. Yep, we'll be doing more of this nonsense in future weeks. We're also on YouTube as Retro Pals. We're starting up production of the new episode of PlayStation Year One, so you're going to see that pretty soon. It's about PGA Tour 96.
Oh, that sounds educational.
Yes, educational. I decided nobody wanted to see a video about PGA Tour 96, so it's also going to have a little bit about the unreleased Madden 96.
Oh,
so
cool.
Please look forward to that. Yeah, we are also on Twitter at RetroPalsHQ, and we recently opened a Discord. You can find the link here on the channel below. We can also post it in chat, I guess.
Mm-hmm. Let me just grab that for you, folks.
Check it out. It got a really good response when we launched it the other day. I was happy to see that. A lot of people just having fun talking about weird games. That's all we want. We just want to get these games out there and for people to first acknowledge they exist, so to confirm we're not crazy. Second of all, to discuss them, just to have fun. Enjoying these games on your own terms. That's the Retro Pals way. What am I talking about? It's time to end the stream.
Oh, maybe, yes. One sec while I grab that link for y'all.
Okay, yeah.
There it is.
There
you
go.
Lay down.
Yep. Oh, also, we will not be back next week. Next week is AGDQ, something you should be watching anyway, and something that makes streaming difficult during that week, so we're just going to sit it out. Do enjoy the speedrunner friends of ours. Cheer them on. Give them some bucks.
Support them all.
Yeah. Watch some fast games. Demand Death Crimson. Right in.
Demand Death Crimson.
Right
for
into
2017.
Right into Mike Uyama. Right into Cool Maddie. Tell him you want to see Death Crimson. Tell him the Retro Pal sent you, and we'll be banned from all future AGDQ events.
We are banned from Twitch.
Anyway, thank you all for watching.
Thank you.
See you in a couple weeks, and good night.
Night, folks.